Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Robert McCorkle, Director of the British Institute of International Comparative Law. Thank you very much for attending what should be a fascinating lecture, and I'm personally delighted that Eleanor Sharpston should honour us by coming to give a lecture, not least because she is somebody who I've respected and actually known quite some time, but also because she has an incredibly busy schedule, not least because she seems to take on more cases than any Advocate General should be ever allowed to take on at any one time. So she's literally flown in here and about to fly out again. So very grateful for her to give this lecture. And the lecture will be chaired by Dame Rosalyn Higgins, who is the former President of the International Court of Justice, but above all, we're deeply proud of the fact she's President of BIICL. After this lecture and the dinner that follows, it's very, very kindly and generously sponsored by Carter Rux Solicitors and Shell, and we're very grateful for that. Afterwards, there is a dinner for those who've registered. In fact, we have a couple of people pulled out, so if anyone would like to attend the dinner, please just say so on your downstairs by registration. And the dinner will be chaired by Susan Bright, Trustee and Managing Partner of Everything at Hogan Lovells, and after dinner speaker will be Sir Paul Jenkins, who's the Trustee and former Treasury Solicitor in the UK. So, thank you again, and I'll leave you in the very capable hands of Dame Rosalyn Higgins.
Well, good evening, everyone. As you hear, we do have a fine evening scheduled for you, and we are indeed extremely grateful that Eleanor Sharpston should have accepted anyway, but particularly at the moment where various unforeseen things have closed in on her, and it's really been very difficult for her to honour this obligation to talk to us, and we really appreciate that she's made it here to us. All persons who reach the judiciary or are an Advocate General can, of course, be expected to have very splendid CV, and that she does have, and I'll say briefly about that in a moment. But there's a whole lot more to Eleanor Sharpston than that, which most of us who have served elsewhere do not at all have. For example, rowing and squash, sailing square riggers, scuba diving, speaking a number of European languages, not just one or two. So all of this, I think, makes her as interesting a person as you would believe from what she has written. She studied economics, languages and law at King's Cambridge, then did some university teaching and research at Corpus Christi, Oxford, called to the bar by the Middle Temple in 1980, and now a bencher of the Middle Temple, and before that had been a barrister in practice and indeed a QC, and she worked as what many of us would call a referendaire, legal secretary in the chambers of the then Advocate General, subsequently, of course, Judge Sir Gordon Slynn, who in turn became Lord Slynn. So that was obviously a fantastic So I know she maintains her contacts with King's College, Cambridge, and we're extremely grateful that in the middle of this very varied and somewhat unusual life, she has found the time in this busy schedule to come and talk to us this evening on the topic that every one of us talks about constantly, namely squaring the circle fighting terrorism while respecting fundamental rights. So thank you very much, and we look forward to hearing you.
Rosalyn, thank you for that extremely courteous and far too fulsome and kind introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. The terrorist threat is sadly never out of the news for long. It is, as we say in the country that I have indeed literally just flown in from this morning into this afternoon, it is d'actualité. 2015 had barely opened before there was the fundamentalist attack on the offices of Charlie Hebdo, plus, of course, a kosher supermarket in Paris. Being a tourist suddenly looked like a rather dangerous option, at least if you had made the unfortunate decision to visit the National Bardo Museum in Tunis on Wednesday, the 18th of March. And then we have that plane that went down inexplicably on Tuesday, Barcelona-Dusseldorf flight, with the loss of 150 lives, many of them very young lives. Now it's beginning to look as though perhaps it was a deranged act of perhaps the co-pilot. But I'm sure that many of us, myself included, had a sinking feeling in the pit of the stomach and wondered if this was not yet another terrorist attack. Now, what I want to do is first to set the scene. And in deference to Hugo Grotius, who had a most marvelously varied career, not just, quotes around the words, just a lawyer, but somebody with an enormous philosophical background, somebody who was a dramatist, somebody who was an apologist for religion, somebody who was very much a Renaissance man. I want to start setting the scene by looking a little bit more broadly than the specific sharp focus to which I shall come later, which is looking at the cases involving listing suspected aiders and abettors of terrorism and freezing their assets. And of course, the natural starting point is to make truism that this is not a new problem. This is perhaps new in the sense of the level of sophistication of the technology that is used to commit acts of terrorism, and that is used to try to forestall them. But the actual problem is really not a new one. And perhaps it's also sensible to say that when one looks at fundamental rights, part of the title of this lecture, one should emphasize that, of course, there are fundamental rights on both sides of the equation. As a citizen, I want my government to protect me. I want the right to walk down the street or to wait for a bus without being blown up by a suicide bomber because I happen to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. I want, if I'm Jewish and live in the Marais in France, in Paris, I want the right to go into the local kosher supermarket and buy my groceries and two fresh chalot for Shabbat without being targeted and killed because of my religious affiliation. Now, safeguarding these fundamental rights is actually not normally labeled as, quote, fundamental rights, comma, protection of. It's usually approached from the perspective of upholding law and order, keeping our streets safe, and so on. But it is important to remember, to bear in mind, that this is not just the law and order slogan. This is about some very basic fundamental rights, starting with the right to life. And it's also appropriate to remember that in order to safeguard those rights, there are people in, for example, the security services who literally may be putting their lives on the line in order to get information that is helpful to forestall attacks. So But that's part of the fundamental rights story, and indeed, within a civilized society, it's usually taken as granted, as a given, but in principle, one is also prepared, in abstract terms at least, to accept that fundamental rights are not just there to protect the ordinary citizen, the good, decent, hard-working citizen, they're also there to protect the unpopular and the marginal. And part of why we now, thankfully, accept that is the unfortunate historical experience from the last century of what happens when Jews or Roma or the disabled or homosexuals start to be perceived as inferior or subhuman and therefore not really persons who should have full rights. They are submention who have lesser or indeed no rights. Well, all right, so far, so good. We know we have fundamental rights to protect the decent citizen. We also know that they will protect, in principle, those on the margin, provided, and it's a big provided, provided they don't represent any threat to society. That's fine, and it goes far enough, doesn't it? Those who commit atrocities, who engage in mindless violence, they are surely beyond the pale, aren't they? See how easy it is to be carried away on the tide of popular rhetoric. The protection of the rights and values of the decent citizen is self-evidently right. I don't need to convince you of that. The temptation is then to go along with the idea that it is obviously so important to nail the perpetrators of atrocities, preferably by preemptive strike, that if necessary, we should simply adjust the rules so that the right side wins. If in so doing we override the suspect's alleged fundamental rights, well, that is necessary in the cause of the greater good. The end justifies the means. Preventing a possible large-scale atrocity, goes the argument, justifies striking a different balance. And the use of these coloured, very non-neutral words, atrocity, barbaric foul acts, mindless violence, that makes it correspondingly more difficult to stand back and talk about, well, rights of the defence. I do pause here to say that I think that avoiding coloured words is a precondition for proper legal analysis and debate in an area such as this. We already know that in relation to immigration, the word bogus has attached itself insidiously as a necessary and consequently always present qualifying adjective for the noun asylum seeker. And we also know that law must not fall into the trap of getting from there to a presumption that this particular applicant for asylum is automatically to be considered a bogus applicant unless he can prove overwhelmingly otherwise. I would suggest to you that similarly, by an application of exactly the same logic, in the wake of an event that will be described on television and retransmitted several times by a political leader as an atrocity of unspeakable barbarity, it is equally necessary for the law not to be bent so as to ensure that any suspect is automatically guilty by association or presumed association. Well, but you may be thinking, why should our enemies benefit from fundamental rights? Now, unlike Hugo de Grotius, I am not in any way qualified to give a philosophy lecture, and be reassured I'm not going to attempt to do that. But there are some points I'd like to note here. We all know that terrorists can be used as a convenient label for enemy of the state. Indeed, we do do not like it when totalitarian regimes do not hesitate to do exactly that, label the elements terrorists, and therefore they are implicitly, of course, people who are unworthy of any due process at all. It's open to manipulation. And I may perhaps be permitted, given the timing of this lecture in the run-up to Easter, to take a historical example here and remind you that the Romans trying to govern Judea regarded the zealots, the Sicarii, or the daggermen, as a dangerous threat to the Pax Romana. And your average law-abiding Roman of the occupying class was probably delighted when another fundamentalist terrorist was captured and nailed up on the cross.